Hello, as she said, my name is Kelly Kruse, and I was an Irish fellow this past year. So my presentation is about my project in Ireland and my whole experience as an Irish fellow. So my project was titled Reporting Live from Ireland. A little bit about me, I'm a junior, I'm from Colorado Springs, Colorado. I'm a broadcasting major and a political science and Spanish minor. I'm also a member of the women's golf team. I'm the executive producer for HC Media, and I'm the politics bureau chief for our public affairs team. When I came to school, I wanted nothing to do with broadcast journalism or news or anything of the sort. I wanted to be a blood spatter analyst for the FBI. So, yeah, and then I was like, man, maybe not. Kind of wanted to be a forensic pathologist, and then I was like, no. Don't think I want to hang out with dead people all the time. I like had like a come to life moment and decided to switch my major. I took a class J term of my freshman year with Sharon Brooks, and it was called Inside the Newsroom. And I just kind of fell in love with the idea of news and reporting. So changed my major, and I've had a lot of great experiences on campus with broadcast journalism. We have a very hands-on department, but my trip to Ireland changed everything. I was able to really immerse myself not only in broadcast journalism, but also in a different country, and it changed my educational experience. So a rundown on the Irish Fellows program. Basically, it's a program each year. You apply in the spring, and you can apply with any sort of project proposal. So students from any department can apply with some sort of proposal on either a research project or an internship or something that you need to be in Ireland for a month to complete. So I applied in the spring and found out that I was accepted late spring. And then I kind of just began making arrangements. Couldn't do a ton before the beginning of the school year, but just over the summer I tried to make a few connections, worked with Dr. Babcock to kind of figure out exactly what I wanted to do while I was there. And then in the fall, there were five of us who were accepted to the program. So in the fall, we began a course called History of Modern Ireland, and that was taught by Dr. Babcock. And he didn't only kind of give us the history of modern Ireland so that we were better prepared to be in their culture and weren't, as he says, stupid tourists, but he also prepared us for the trip itself. So what to take, what it's gonna be like living there for a month. He took us out there for a couple of days, but then left us, so we were there very on our own. So he prepared us to kind of go to Ireland for a month, and then when we went, we were there for 4.5 weeks, and we all worked on our projects for that month in Ireland. We lived in Lahinch, Ireland, which is on the west coast in County Clare. It's a very small town, it's the surfing capital of Ireland, but it's a beautiful, beautiful place. And so we were all there for a month, and then we came back at the end of October, finished up our projects, finished up the course, and went on our way. So that's kind of the rundown of the Irish Fellows program. So my project in particular focused on broadcast journalism. My main point of the project was to complete 3 feature video stories. So I wanted to get some hands-on experience reporting in Ireland. So I came up with 3 story ideas before I left. Some of them changed while I was there. But I came up with a rough idea of what I wanted to do, who I wanted to interview, and what I wanted to come back with. So I took a bunch of camera equipment with me, and what I spent most of my time doing was getting video shots of things for my stories, interviewing people, and completing those stories. So those were the 3 most important parts of my project. But then I also worked on a promotional video for the program itself. So I was actually able to use a lot of footage from my stories, but then also got some footage of the other fellows doing their projects and research, and put together a promo video for the program and for the school to be able to use. And then I did a little bit of side research on the news industry of Ireland compared to America. So it wasn't a very structured like research project because mine was more focused on the hands-on video stuff, but I did look in a little bit to the news industry of Ireland. So this is where the technical difficulties begin because we don't have audio. So it's we do have audio, but it's really quiet. So I'm sorry if you can't hear it very well. But here I'm going to show you guys my stories. So my first story was on Davy Spillan, our sponsor. So he lives on top of the Cliffs of Moher in Ireland, and he's a Grammy Award-winning musician. And we met him for the first time when we were very jet-lagged, sick to our stomachs, and just wanted to go to bed. But he made the day a lot better because he's one of the best people I have ever met. So he kind of looked after us once Dr. Babcock left. And he checked in on us every once in a while, and we went up to his house every week for dinner, and he just kind of was our, we called him Uncle Davo, so that was just kind of what he was. But so I wasn't planning on doing a story on Davy, but I was going to do one on the Cliffs of Moher, and that fell through because they had all these requirements for taking video. So I was like, okay, what do I want to do? Then I thought, okay, we're literally practically here with a Grammy award-winning musician. He's insanely talented and he has a crazy awesome story. So I said, Davy, would you ever mind just doing an interview and kind of helping me out with my project? And he said, of course. So that's what I did my first story on. And here it is.
Atop the Cliffs of Moher in County Clare, Ireland, lives a man with a story unlike any other. Davy Spillan is a musician, songwriter, and a player of the Uilleann pipes and the low whistle. It all began back when he was 12 years old and got stuck with the pipes as his instrument for music class.
All that was left was the Uilleann pipes. So it's kind of like an accident. I mean, that's all that was left was them, because the bully big guys got banjos and all these other things.
But as he kept playing, he began to take more of an interest and eventually became obsessed with it. He started playing on the streets at the age of 14, ran away from home, and chased his dreams.
I was impassioned by the famous gypsy pipers that were before me, so I had this sort of mission thing, you know, about the gypsy piper thing, and I wanted to be like the famous guys from the 30s that did that.
By the early 80s, Davy was in Dublin and had joined the rock band Moving Hearts.
It was a very successful and very famous band. We played like 5, 6, 7 nights a week to 3, 4,000 people a night.
After being center stage for 4 or 5 years with them, Spillan started his own band named Davy Spillan Band.
We were kind of a little heavy rock band. I got signed to Sony. I was going up and down England competing like with all the kind of rocky guys, and I was doing with no singer, just me playing the pipes of my rock band. We were out doing all the English bands. Sony signed me to Sony London, you know.
The deals didn't stop there. He got a Sony deal at Madison Avenue in New York and then proceeded to get another one in Japan. But Davy isn't only known for his playing ability. He's known for making his own instruments as well.
Just a, like, aluminium tube. See that? Like plumbing, right? And you cut it to length and you put the holes in it and you shape it, and I'll show you that in a moment, but that's the basic materials, right? Now this is called a low whistle, okay? Which is a low flute.
He has a workshop and a recording studio in his home by the cliffs.
It is a bit cool to see raw materials from the jungle, literally, and then the sound coming out of the speakers in the studio. I mean, like, that's a bit of a journey, isn't it?
Davy's passion and drive led him to where he is today. About 18 years ago, he found a new passion with the Coast Guard and has been working with them since. But he still makes music on the side and will always be known for his influence in the industry.
I was a very passionate young man, and I had such a lot of interests, and my father had set me up with a sort of Renaissance interest in lots of things, you know. So I'm very proud of that, and I know it was a kind of unusual childhood, you know, very unusual youth. Like, I had a very strange life, very beautiful life.
Reporting for HC Media, this is Kelly Kruse.
Thank you. All right, so that was my first story. Davy was great to work with, and sorry. That's okay. Thank you.
Oh, should be okay. There we go.
Okay. So yeah, Davey was great to work with, and I'm actually so glad that I ended up doing a story on him because I was able to learn so much more about him, and he was just a great person to know while we were in Ireland. I still email back and forth with him today, so it was awesome to be able to do a story on him. So my next story was on the John McCarthy Lahinch Surf School. So I knew going to Ireland that I wanted to do a story on the surfing culture, which I thought that was weird because I didn't know that people surfed in Ireland, but when we kind of found out where we were going to Lahinch, and that it was this surfing capital, I did some research, and I guess people come to Lahinch and other places on the West Coast to surf from all over Europe and all over the world. So I did a little bit of research, but I wasn't sure exactly what my story was going to be. I just knew I wanted it to be something about surfing. So I got to Lahinch, and a few days in, I think it was only like, it was like our first weekend there, a couple of the girls wanted to surf, so I went down there with them to the surf school that they were going to, and it was this John McCarthy Lahinch Surf School. And I talked to John a little bit, and he started the first surf school in Lahinch. So I thought, okay, that's perfect. I will do my story on that. So not only did I do a story, but you know, we became kind of buddies with these guys and surfed like 4 times, and it was great. So it was a lot of fun getting to meet them and interviewing them and doing the story. But here's this one. Do you want to hold it again? Okay.
Want to catch some waves in an extravagant place? Ireland has become a country with more to offer than pubs and puddles. It has grown into a surfing hub as well.
Around the time of the Celtic Tiger, that's when surfing became very popular because people had a lot of money to spare. And so surfing was definitely one of the things that people did.
The west coast of Ireland has several popular surfing spots, but the town of Lahinch is home to one of the most well-known ones.
The beauty of Lahinch is that the waves, they don't come in really intense and crash onto the beach. They really come in and gently, slowly break. So that's a real benefit for surf schools. It's not a very particularly, it's not an intense place.
In 2002, surfer John McCarthy was looking for a change of pace and opened the first full-time surf school in Lahinch.
I bought 13 surfboards. I started doing surf lessons, and very quickly, the kids' surf camps became very popular. And within 6 months, I had decided that I was going to try and pursue the surf school to make a living.
As time passed, more people came to surf and more schools opened for business. But John McCarthy's Lahinch Surf School is still teaching year-round and has a lot to offer.
We do group surf lessons, we do school tours, we get hen and stag parties, we get birthday parties. So, and in summertime we do kids camps, so that's very busy.
But McCarthy doesn't spend all of his time at the school. Since the age of 10, he has worked his way to surfing world-class waves.
By the age of 15, I was on the Irish surf team. By the age of 16, I was the Irish junior champion. So I competed for Ireland. And then along the way, for someone who kind of wasn't a very good swimmer, I got more confident and became a big wave surfer. And so then I started surfing the big wave at the Cliffs of Moher.
A wave that breaks in a very particular place at a particular time and attracts surfers from all over the world.
Yesterday we were out there and the 3-time world champion Mick Fanning was out there. So it's one of the best waves in the world and it's one of the most difficult waves in the world.
The North Atlantic has a mind of its own, but whether you're a professional surfer or trying to stand up for the first time, the west coast of Ireland has the waves to ride.
What's different about surfing in Ireland than, say, California, the Atlantic is a smaller ocean, but it's a more intense ocean. So it's very raw, but on a good day, when everything comes together, the waves are great.
Reporting for HC Media, this is Kelly Kruse.
Okay, and then my third story, I'm not going to show you guys just because since the audio and we started a little bit late. But my third one was on the Lahinch Golf Club, and I also knew going to Ireland that I wanted to do a story on golf because I play golf and I love golf, and Ireland is like the place to golf. So I knew that there was I knew that this golf club was where we were going to be living, so I thought that was perfect. So I went down there and it was kind of weird because I've done this whole reporting thing like at the college, and I was an intern in at a station in Colorado Springs, so I've definitely done it before, and I know how to ask people if they would like to be interviewed and all that, but it's completely different when you're on your own. It was a very good like real world experience being out there doing this all on my own. I learned so much because it's completely different when you just you're not doing a story on campus where people know that, oh, HC Media has to do stories, so yeah, I'll do the interview. This is completely an independent thing. People don't have to say yes. They don't have to be nice to you. But everyone was very nice, luckily. And so I went out to the golf course, and I just asked them. I told them what I was doing. I kind of gave them a rundown of this whole Irish Fellows program. And not only did they let me do a story, but they let me play for free, so it was a great experience. So yeah, it was really fun. I met with that was the historian, Inda Glenn. So I interviewed him and got some cool shots of the course. And then I did a promo video, and this is a promo video. You guys can all watch it on YouTube. It's just a cool promo video with an awesome interview with Dr. Babcock at the end. So yeah, once again, it was definitely an awesome experience doing this like hands-on reporting in Ireland on my own. It was kind of a pain having to carry around all that camera equipment all the time, but it was so much fun, and I learned so much, not only about reporting and all of that kind of stuff, but just getting to talk to people and interview people, and I learned so much about Ireland, and I learned a lot about what it's like to be a reporter and all that, so it was awesome. So then my kind of side research that was on the news industry itself, I found out that there's quite a few similarities between like news in America and news in Ireland, but it's a little bit different because they only have one national news station. It's kind of like BBC, it's called RTE. So they do news, television broadcasts, radio broadcasts, all of that, but then they also have, it's like, you know, NBC, they have like The Tonight Show. It's called like The Tonight Show or something like that. So they have all of those kind of shows too. But there's only one station, so instead of like CNN, NBC, Fox, all that, they only have RTE. So a lot of people think it's kind of biased because here, while there's different stations and different ones may be biased, you can kind of find the one that fits you, whereas RTE, there's only one. So some people, I'm sure, enjoy it, but others might not like to watch it. It's just interesting since there's only one station. And then a lot of people do watch the news. I found out just from talking to people at the pub and where else, a lot of people do watch the news and read the newspapers to get their news, but a lot of people also just kind of talk to each other, and it's definitely still, it's a very, I don't know how to explain it, but it's kind of like an eclectic place, and people talk to get their news, and word of mouth is a thing, and all of that kind of stuff. So, yeah, and I wanted to tour RTE when we were in Dublin, but there was like a 7-month wait, so I guess that was something I should have done organized before we got there, but it's okay, that just gives me a reason to go back. And then we did do a lot of work. It was definitely an educational experience, but the reason that I loved Irish Fellows program so much is because it allows you to just be independent and immerse yourself into another culture. You're not only focused on the educational aspect. So I remember before we went, Dr. Babcock emphasized the fact that you have to get your work done because you can't go back if you don't finish. So it was, you know, we had to each work a lot on time management and all that kind of stuff. It's not like you have, I mean, I had interviews and stuff, so I did have certain places I had to be at certain times, but it's not like you have to wake up for class or wake up for this. You're completely on your own time, doing your own thing, and you can go do whatever, whenever. So there was 5 of us, and we all got our work done and made sure we did those things, but we also had a lot of fun, and I learned so much about Ireland, and I want to live there. It was great. I golfed, we all surfed, we lived in Lahinch, but we went to Galway for a weekend, we went to Dublin for a week, we toured different national museums and the Guinness factory and all of those good things. So it was an incredible experience. I would do it again if I could. I asked Dr. Babcock if I could, but he said I couldn't. So it was great. We're trying to figure out something with Davey to where alum can go drive the future Irish fellows around because we didn't have a car. That was kind of a pain, but we still got to do all the things that we wanted to do. And I got everything done that I wanted to get done. I got my 3 video packages done, and while it kind of didn't go exactly how it was planned, I was gonna do a story on the cliffs. That didn't happen. I think it worked out all for the best, and I learned a lot, and it was great. So yeah, that's all I got. Any questions? Yeah. Yes.
How big did you say the waves got?
They're big waves. You guys should all, it's insane. If you look up like the Cliffs of Moher wave, like surfing under the Cliffs of Moher, it is nuts. It's like a 60-foot wave. And I mean, if you don't successfully ride the wave in, I have a feeling you just get like thrown into the side of a cliff. So it's pretty intense. But yeah, no, we were at the top of the cliffs, like walking around, and you could look down and you just saw these little specks, and those are people surfing down there. It's crazy. Yes?
The golf shot at the end, did you set that up yourself or did somebody actually?
No, it's actually a funny story. When I was interviewing, when I was there interviewing the historian, this group of like 3 guys, probably all in their 60s and 70s, came up to me and asked me, oh, what are you doing here, blah, 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 you're from America, what? So, and I was telling them that I golfed, and they were like, well, are you golfing out here? And I said, yes, I'm actually like scheduled to play tomorrow. And they were all members out there, but they were also all caddies. So one of them was like, oh, I have to caddy for you. And I was like, okay, sure. So I went out and golfed, and this guy caddied for me, and we played with a couple from Boston. And it was really funny and a great time. And then we all drank some Guinness afterwards. So yeah, it was a good time. Yeah, so my caddy took that picture.
Okay.
It's the only time I've had a caddy, but yeah, that's fine with me. Yeah.
Did you learn anything about the aquatic life regarding the surfing aspect? Like, did they tell you about any of the
sharks or anything like that?
Yes, in particular. Great whites or baskings?
Nope. I cannot say I did. Yeah, it's freezing. It's freezing. But, I mean, I'm sure there's something scary in there. I didn't really think about it too much.
Water.
Yeah, it's freezing. But I will say the warmest we ever were on the trip was when we were in our wetsuits in the ocean. It is crazy how those things work. But, yeah. Yep.
So when you were in all these pubs, what were the Irish doing? Were they all staring at their phones?
It's a little bit different there, definitely. There's live music in, like, every pub, and it is in Lahinch, where we lived, it's a lot of locals, but then also on the weekends there would be a lot of tourists, so we were surrounded by a lot of Irish people, but also like Australians and people from France all the time. All these people would come to surf in Lahinch. And it's definitely, I feel like I didn't see a lot of people on their phones and stuff. People are just super engaged like with each other and with, especially with the live music aspect and all that kind of stuff. It's unlike any scene I've ever been to before. It's definitely, people are really engaged with each other, and it's like it's a real place.
Can we all give another round of applause for Kelly for not only being awesome, but also rolling with all the people?
Yeah. You're good.
There are approximately 576,000 golf courses in the world, but one club tucked away in the west coast of Ireland stands out among the rest.
For the very earliest years, people came from all over the world, from all parts of England, Scotland and Wales, to play golf in Lahinch.
2 courses make up the Lahinch Golf Club, the Castle Course and the Old Course. The Old Course is ranked 31st in the world according to top 100 golf courses, and it all started back in 1892.
On Good Friday, 1892, the whole place changed.
The Merchant Princes of Limerick, along with the Black Watch Regiment, found the sand hills by the sea in Lahinch a perfect place to launch a golf course.
Lieutenant McFarland from the Black Watch Regiment and William MacDonald. Okay. That was the first game that was played in 1892, and Lahinch has never looked back since then.
A poor area at the time, golf brought much prosperity to Lahinch. While some locals took the opportunity to caddy, others, such as John Burke, who fought in the War of Independence, began to make their names as golfers.
John Burke was a wonderful golfer. He was the best golfer of his generation. He joined the club in 1928 and he won every title imaginable in Ireland.
But it's not only about the titles and trophies. Lahinch Golf Club has more to offer than that.
All the young people that caddied, their horizons were broadened. They could hold their place anywhere because of the contact with all these people from England and all parts of Ireland and America and Europe that come here, and their minds were opened. And I always felt it was a very good education for the local young people starting out caddying here in Lahinch. It changed their perspective, and I felt once you got this grounding in education here in the golf course, you could hold your place anywhere in the world.
With a mixture of caddies, members, locals and visitors, their international brand is just as prestigious as their local one.
I remember James E. Maher said one time when he became a captain, he was a famous captain, a famous surgeon in Dublin, he said, Lahinch is no local club, it's a national club with an international reputation.
Reporting for HC Media, this is Kelly Kruse.
Irish Fellows began 11 years ago. It was the brainchild of then Dean Richard Lloyd and our partner in Ireland, the Grammy Award winning musician Davy Spillane. And it's built around two realities for the Hastings College student. The first of them is that virtually every major at Hastings College requires a research project by the time the students graduate. And the second is that Hastings College students are so involved in so many things, be it athletics or other organizations, forensics, that it's the rare Hastings College student who has the space to spend a semester studying overseas. So Irish Fellows intensifies that, gives them a month in Ireland to conduct research, which they then follow up, write up, and present when they come back. It's not for everyone. There are certain majors where it's very difficult to find to be able to take a month out of the semester. But with the support of the Hastings College administration and the support of individual Hastings College professors, many students have been able to take advantage of this opportunity. First thing a student should do is approach a professor and say, I'm interested in conducting research in Ireland. Preferably, I'm interested in conducting research in Ireland on this topic. Once the student finds a professor who is willing to sponsor that research, they then put together a grant application in which they outline what the research question is. They demonstrate that the research is doable, at the very least that the data is collectible in that month time in Ireland. And they should demonstrate some foresight. They should have contacted people in Ireland. They should have done their homework. The proposal should be something much more than, I'd kind of like to go to Ireland and maybe like to see what news looks like there. If they don't know who to contact, if they don't know how to do this homework, as I'm calling it, they should come and talk to me. We can connect them. After the grant is proposed, after the committee has identified the Irish Fellows, students sign up for a semester-long course in modern Irish history, which is both a course to prepare them to go and live in Ireland, and also a course to give them a cultural and historical context to the Ireland that they'll be living in. In October, after having made arrangements with all of their classroom professors to either do or make up any of the work that is going to be missed, so these can only be our most responsible students, the fellows get to go to Ireland, where they live in the surfing capital of Ireland, the beachside city of Lahinch, right near one of the most famous golf courses in the world, right down the road from the Cliffs of Moher, or the Cliffs of Insanity if you're a Princess Bride fan. And they share a house and share space, but are very much on their own in terms of pursuing their individual endeavors. We've had students who have engaged in internships, had to get up every morning and go a mile into Ennistymon to work on a publishing internship. We've had students who have conducted archival research, get up every morning and take the bus into Ennis and spend their times in the archives of the Clare County Library. We've had students who are engaged in, I guess, what one would call more kind of hands-on or proactive things, either working with local agencies or job shadowing, as in the case of a student who job shadowed the Clare Champion, the local Clare newspaper. We've also had students who've gone as far afield as Dublin and London to conduct research that has to do with their Irish Fellows project. We've also had creative projects, students who have painted or who have generated a body of artwork which they then bring back to Hastings and finish up. So really this is a project that is limited only by the student's imagination and the support that they can secure from a Hastings College professor.